Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. Thanks, Jens. Good morning, everyone. So I'm the last obstacle before you can get your well-deserved coffee. So I will talk about the right to leave from the EU Fundamental Rights Agency, briefly FRA, perspective. And I will put my EU law-centered contribution in the context of existing and upcoming FRA research. My focus is on the involvement of EU member states and EU agencies in encouraging obstacles to the right to leave where the destination is the European Union. To start with a preliminary remark, just to recall that the right to leave is not in the EU Charter of Fundamental Rights as such, but we can consider it as a general principle of EU law in application of Article 6, para 3 of the Treaty on the EU. So this norm, this human right, binds the EU as an entity and not only the member states. So the right to leave in the EU context is not to be mixed up with the rights of freedom of movement, primarily for EU citizens or legally staying third country nationals. This is to set aside. Then in my short presentation, I will try to make four main points. The first one relates to two scenarios which are taken from a FRA research paper produced recently. These two scenarios are those which are relevant in the context of the right to leave. First, let's assume that EU member state vessels patrol the territorial waters of a third country based on an agreement with that third country. And the vessels prevent migrants from reaching the high seas, for example, by stopping the boats, forcing them to turn back, or conducting the migrants back to the third country's shore. This practice exists, that was the case with the Spanish seahorse operation, or also in Frontex-led joint operation HERA in the territorial waters of Senegal and Mauritania. So this is a scenario when member states' vessels are actually in territorial waters of third countries and pullbacks or prevention of departures take place in that area. Or, just one step further, we have now this UNAVFOR MED Operation Sophia. If it will move to its next phases, the second phase and third phase, also patrolling and taking measures in the territorial sea of Libya, which is of course subject to UN Security Council resolution as authorizing acts and or the consent of the third country. But if it happens, the EU's responsibility for contributing to the possible violations of the right to leave might come up as well. So not only the member states, but the EU as such, as an entity, in light of the articles of the responsibility of international organizations, either independently or jointly with member states. And the same applies for Frontex in joint operations at sea. It's a legal possibility. Second scenario. Let's assume that we are at the green border or at the boundary between member states' territorial sea and the third country territorial sea, and border guards identify people moving towards the border and suspect that they intend to cross the border in an unauthorized manner. So they request assistance from the third country to intercept them before they cross the border. Such cooperation is possible based on bilateral agreements between an EU member state and the neighboring third country. So if such EU member states share data or intelligence information with third countries on movement of people towards the border, it might help the third countries to stop migrants or asylum seekers leaving and picking them up. So it's also a scenario of prevention of departures where EU member states can contribute. So even if this is envisaged, this kind of info sharing by the Eurosur regulation, this regulation establishing the European border surveillance system, it might have negative repercussions on this human right. Although the Eurosur regulation contains a safeguard clause in Article 20, para 5, to protect those in need of international protection, it's still a legal issue. And when it comes to responsibility of member states, we can, and we identified in the report, arguments for and against the exercise of control by member states. If we take, if we argue that member states can be responsible, it can take the form of complicity in case of aiding or abetting the third countries in application of the articles on on state responsibility, Article 16, or it can amount to a joint responsibility with the third country concerned as well in application of Article 4 of the articles on state responsibility. So more on those are in our paper on the application of the principle of non-refoulement in border management scenarios. And also we produced a Sea Borders report in 2013, which also has some findings on this prevention of departures. Second point, the Italian-Libyan Memorandum of Understanding, which was concluded just 1 year ago, which outlines actions which primarily focus on securitizing Libya's borders and preventing departures. Also, Italian military assets are deployed in Libyan territorial borders, and financial support to border management has been envisaged. So, in case of real-time sharing of information with Libyan authorities on locations where migrants embark or found at the territorial sea by the Italian authorities, this is a case where the right to leave is affected, or this practice goes at variance with the right to leave, and Italy's responsibility might arise. Because of this Italian-Libyan cooperation, many people remain stranded in Libya, we know, in inhuman conditions, in detention. So reaction, discussions on legal entry channels re-emerged. Just think of the Bern meeting of the Central Mediterranean Contract Group last November. And at this meeting, states decided on evacuations for those in need of international protection, especially vulnerable people. And here one might ask, can we conceive evacuations to Italy as exercising the right to leave with state assistance? The first round has been completed with roughly 200 people arriving in Italy. Simon Mordu also mentioned that almost 1,500 people have been evacuated to various EU member states during the last couple of months. So open questions are there. And this cooperation is not only with Italy, but that similar examples exist with Spain and West African countries. And more information on this can be found in our fundamental rights report, which will be out in May. My third point briefly, carrier sanctions. We know that carrier sanctions affect the right to leave a country. So travel companies are made responsible for the actions of passengers they transport. They have to check their travel documents and visas. So it's a sort of privatization and externalization of migration controls. And in this situation, carriers are being afraid of punishment. So they resort to two restrictive practices and discriminatory profiling, which leads to the prevention of departures. And it's not only in this sea context, but via land borders. It was a big issue when it comes to departing from Western Balkans countries. And my last point, fourth point, the use of the Interpol's stolen and lost travel documents database and other Interpol databases. Oppressive regimes are inclined to record travel documents of political opponents in these systems as stolen or lost, even if it's not the case, just to prevent them from leaving. So over-reliance by member states on those databases, like the SLTD, can actually impede the departure of those people in need of international protection. For instance, if a document is found in the SLTD, the majority of the EU member states will automatically refuse a visa application if it's revealed in the process. So now that interoperability of various IT systems at the EU level is flying high on the political agenda, when these EU IT systems become interoperable, for instance, when the SIS document section will speak to the SLTD, information originating from third countries that may be consulted through interoperability should not be taken at face value. So member states need to be aware that third countries wishing to limit the possibilities of persons in need of protection, such as political opponents, may report the travel documents as stolen or lost to try to prevent them from leaving. So this is a surface, this is a, 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 a context where EU member states must be vigilant once again. More information on those interconnections can be found in our upcoming report on the fundamental rights implications of biometric data in large EU IT systems in the fields of borders, visa and asylum, as we briefly call it. This is the biometrics report, which will be out at the end of March. So I stop here, and I'm happy to take any questions you might have. Thank you for your attention.